fellow learners, welcome back to Hades. You probably remember that after the Titanomachy, Zeus became king of the gods and the world was shared by the three sons of Cronus. While Earth and Mount Olympus remained common property, Zeus got the sky as his private property, Poseidon got the sea, and Hades got the underworld. From then on, it was impossible to discriminate between the inflexible king of death and his awful kingdom. Both of them were called by the same scary name, Hades. Clues to the location of Hades' house are unclear and contradictory. It is often situated at the western border of the known world, with a complex network of rivers, such as Acheron, Cocytus and Styx, not far from the ocean, the primordial river. With Zeus's consent, Hades kidnapped the young Persephone, also known as Cori, the Latin Proserpina. Demeter, the mother of Persephone and the goddess of agriculture and harvest, despaired of finding her daughter and threatened to destroy humankind if Hades did not give her back. Finally, a compromise was reached, and Persephone spends 8 months of the year on Earth with her mother and 4 months with her husband in the underworld. This mythical event was to inaugurate a return trip that very few heroes had the chance to experience. Let us focus on Heracles, Dionysus, and Orpheus, who undertook genuine catabasis. That is, descends into the underworld. Among his famous 12 labors, Heracles was required to capture Cerberus. Hesiod does not mention Heracles' labors, but describes the monstrous dog, Cerberus, who eats raw flesh, the brazen-voiced hound of Hades, 50 head, relentless and strong. Even if the number of heads varies from one source to another, Cerberus is visibly a frightening figure. Nonetheless, Heracles succeeded in mastering him without any weapon. He took Cerberus out of the underworld, showed him to his rival cousin Eurystheus, and brought him back to Odysseus' house. While in the underworld, Heracles managed to deliver the arrow Theseus. According to certain tradition, Heracles made another successful catabasis to take Alcestis, the dead wife of his host, Admetus, back to Earth. Just like Heracles, Dionysus was the son of Zeus and a human woman. His mother, called Semele, was killed by Zeus' thunderbolt before his birth. When he had grown up, Dionysus managed to descend into the underworld and to bring her to Olympus, where she became a goddess. Orpheus, the legendary musician, was less successful than Heracles and Dionysus. He descended to Hades' house and softened the spirits of the dead with his music, hoping to take his dead wife Eurydice back to Earth. Was his love for her not strong enough? Could he not resist the temptation to look back to her? Whatever the case, he returned alone to Earth. Odysseus, in the Nekuia of the Odyssey, came very near to the underworld, although he did not really enter it. The first shade he met was his companion Elpenor, who explained to him how he died and begged him for a proper funeral. Just afterwards, Tiresias gave Odysseus some advice for his journey back home. He also spoke with his dead mother, Anticlea. He saw many dead heroines and heroes and shared a few words with fellow Greek warriors at Troy, Agamemnon and Achilles, while Ajax obstinately refused to speak to him. The last one he spoke to was the shade of Heracles. But these intrusions of living heroes into the underworld remained exceptional. The realm of Hades was not easy to access. It was necessary to cross one or more rivers and to observe many rites and precautions. Finally, Cerberus, the monstrous dog at the entrance, did not normally allow any living being to come in, nor any shade to leave it after entering. Let's also stress that Odysseus saw Minos rendering justice in the underworld, while being surrounded by Letygians, although there is no clear allusion here to an hypothetical judgment of the souls. The realm of Hades and Persephone, also known as Hades' house or simply Hades, is the place where the shades of dead heroes went after death, provided they had received the proper funeral rites and burial, but without any notion of punishment, even if Hades in itself seemed to be a terrible residence. Hades is simply the final destination for every human being. According to Hesiod's Works and Days, 5 different ages have taken place since the creation of human beings. Back in Cronus' days, during the Golden Age, the first generation of humans used to live together with the gods. After their death and their burial in the ground, they became superhumans upon the earth and guardians of human beings. The second generation of humans during the Silver Age did not show respect to the gods, so that Zeus buried them and they became the blessed of the underworld. The third generation, the men of the Bronze Age, killed each other with their own hands and went without any glory to the house of Hades. The heroes of the fourth generation were killed during the Theban and the Trojan Wars. These demigods were ruled by Cronus, and they were allowed to stay at the edges of the earth, separated from other humans and far away from the gods, in the Isles of the Blessed, on the banks of ocean. This location is called elsewhere Elysian or the Elysian Fields. Finally, the fifth generation, which is also our generation, is toiling and suffering through days and nights during the Iron Age. Like the first four generations, the fifth one is doomed to destruction and will be covered with earth. King or slave, rich or poor, good or bad, every human will eventually experience the gloomy Hades. And we shall leave the last word to Achilles, who deliberately chose to die at Troy in the flower of youth to gain the everlasting glory of the Iliad. I would rather be a paid servant in a poor man's house and be above ground than king of kings among the dead. We hope to have shed some light on these difficult topics which reappear, albeit with difference and sometimes further developments, in all subsequent descriptions and evocations of the underworld in antiquity and in the Middle Age, the most famous of which are Plato, Phaedo and Gorgias, Virgil's Aeneid, and Dante's That Divine Comedy.